Thank you. very exciting. Sounds really exciting. I love the way you play. Sometimes it sounds fantastic. When it's bad, it sounds good. So, I mean, it's always good. But the best you played with the sound is the ending. It was fantastic. Yeah. No, just the ending. Can you just play that? When you have the tone, it's totally perfect. But don't think about it. No, just play what you did before. It's like perfect sound. Before you didn't vibrate either. You didn't vibrate before. No. Do it again. But it was a little more chords with the sound. That was there, like there. So I think you're very instinctive, because when you play good, you got to know what you do, so you can.
Yeah.
Because it's not as good as before, but because you knew it's the ending, so you just relaxed. So just the ending. So play it again. Like okay. Sometimes one can analyze one's own intuition. If you, when you have very intuitive player. You can watch what you do when you feel really great and it sounds good. Then observe what it is that you do. Then you can learn to copy yourself.
Yeah.
So play the ending without thinking about it. That tone is totally controlled. Try to play the ending now. Try to play that metaphor without vibrato again. See if you can control it at a higher dynamic. So it's not as good. So why is that? So when it doesn't sound good, why doesn't it sound good? Because you're going here. So it's like, I don't want. But if you go parallel, you know, it sounds good. Drop the tip and don't let it move. It doesn't sound good. I mean, if you come up, it sounds good. So if you have to, of course, if you let the bow move, you could do anything you want. As long as you, in the moment you don't let it move and you're not parallel. If you want an edge, it's okay to have an edge, if that's what you want. But when you get, it's like, it's here, it sounds good. Over here, it doesn't sound good. Over here, it's too. So you want to be close to the line. But what you did is, if you go here, if I go up, oh, I'm going to let it move, then it won't sound bad. You can make it sound really good when you go like that. You can do even more, you know, then it goes faster. You just have to slow it down as you get closer to the bridge so you get a good sound. If you want to go here. This sounds good. You can even make a good sound like that, as long as you don't go that way.
Okay.
So I think it's important when it doesn't sound good to spend maybe 15 minutes a day and say, why doesn't it sound? Because you know what good is, because you're very musical, you have very good ear, and you're taught very well. So you know a lot of stuff, but you can analyze what you do more objectively yourself. So funny was, because when you played soft, you got away with going this way. But when you're louder, doesn't work, so then you better go. So if you have a choice, parallel or a little bit towards the fingerboard. The reason being that the string vibrates, the Helmholtz vibrating. When you start here, it shoots to the bridge, then it shoots up there, and it comes back. So when you go like here, you block that thing from, it doesn't want to travel. But so now. My goal was to just let you play that phrase and then you would be great and then I could use that everywhere.
Okay.
But it didn't work. My idea was not good. But it was still okay to talk about that.
Yeah.
So you're out too far here. You just want to go here. Just go there. You go here. Then you're, but it's a good thing you have a very long arm. But a lot of people with short arms, they're jealous. They have to go, they can't reach there. You'd have to move the cello over there. But you go there, you just have to, don't go.
Okay.
You're doing too much. You just stay there. You come out too much. It's not that big a difference. It's the only big difference is between the G and the D, because you're at the top. So if you go here, just mess it like there.
Okay.
That's where you want to be, on each string. So you go here, then move up. Or you go here. I know it's very basic. I did not intend to get into that. I was not planning that, but you, when you go up on the G, you're too far out. Just stay this. Just go. Just come up there. But I think it's good. Play it now like that, so it sounds good. Play the bow like this way. So you go here, you know, then you move. But just do it like more. Try to play the piano again like you did the first, the piano version. Yeah, now play the theme in the beginning. So there, why don't you go, when you go here, play it, then come back a little bit, slow it down, you just go slower, so do one or the other bit, slow it down. At your level of playing, your intonation could be one level higher. I mean, you're terrific, but if you're an international competitor, you've got to play one level higher. How do you practice to play? Like, can you play an E major scale in tune? I know I normally don't start talking about intonation. I'm sorry. I've not done that for like 2 years. Somebody say, I don't know. Don't ask me. But now, how do you find the first E in the E major scale? How do you find that E?
I check it with
the G. Can you do that? Yeah. If you do that, you're going to be really out of tune. When I was young and I used to play, I would practice that all the time. And then I go play Brahms E minor, and it's so out of tune. I say, what's wrong with the piano? And then I tune to the piano. I mean, just, but the E you want to tune to is the A string E.
Yeah.
Play the harmonic on the A string. Because you're an A major. So if you, so the E you have to have is, so play first in A major. Can you do an A major scale? Going on. I mean, your intonation is like 95% good, but it's not 100%. I think you could be more critical. Play an A major, just up the A string. How do you find the B? If you have two Bs, to B and not to B, there's nothing to do with that. But you have like, you have this B, and then you have this B. This B is a Pythagorean B. That's a B that tunes with this. If you play that E, if somebody says they don't use that B, if you play a jazz scale, it's still the same B. It would be that B. You never use this B. You never use that. Not in A major. Because when you do jazz tuning, you always tune in the key. So the pitch is changed. Yeah. But if you do melodic tuning, it's always the same. So you always use the E. That E. And the same with the B. You can find it. You can find it there also. So if you find the B, because people have a hard time finding that B. If you play the low B, and you play it with the high B, this B is it fits with the piano. Same with this, it totally fits with the piano. If you play the low, it's way flat with the piano. Same with this E. So I think, play now an A major where you use the high B. I mean, if you want to find that B, you can play here. So it's a high B. If you tune with the G, it's too high. So all tuning is just about the syntonic comma, the 22 cents difference between melodic tuning and jazz tuning. But for the B, when I found that, man, I love that. I said, wow. Because people have, they always play like Dvorak. Of course, once you vibrate, it doesn't matter because you vibrate so wide. So it covers it all up. And also, if somebody totally tunes justly, and they have a good ear, then they adjust to the piano anyway, but I don't feel you totally adjust. There's one more level you can, so knowing a little bit about it is, people that have great ears don't need to know anything, except if they teach people that don't have great ears. Then you can help them. The reason I got into it was I was frustrated from years for teaching. I had one student, she studied for 10 years, and then she went away and came back, and then she played out of tune. And I said, we spent 10 years doing that. And I mean, so I think if there is a, when you understand the theories, you can train your ear. Once you train your ear, you don't know what to think about it. And you never want to talk to anybody about it. You play with a violinist that doesn't know about it and has better intonation. Don't start telling them anything. If you're in a quartet, whoever has a better ear, that's the person you let say how to tune. Don't argue if you know something. But your ear is, could be a little bit better. Play now, play it in an A major scale. So if you want to test the B, now if you play a harmonic, if you push it down there, what happens to the pitch besides it's a low octave? If you push the strength down, it goes, the pitch goes higher. So you have to match by going lower. The higher the string is above the fingerboard. If the string is really high, then you have to lower it a lot, because when you're pushing a string, you are stretching the string so the pitch goes up. So you go a little, even hearing that, yeah, a little high. Then if you go lower, now you get the lower, then you get the low of the E string. Play that harmonic and try to match it. I'm sorry, this is not nice to you, because if you work on the example, but I think for his life, it's good to, he's not the right one. Not totally right. If you try to do it right at the spot. So that's a little high, so just very, it's very little, you have to go lower. It's better. And then you go, then tune the B. That's a perfect fourth. And one thing, when we tune double stop, I see very often people play a note and then they tune the double stop and then they move the other notes. So you have to know what note tunes to what note. So if you play thirds, it's the bass, the low note is a melody. And you could do melodic tuning and still tune justly to the melody. That's one thing I didn't get into until after I've spent a lot of time with the cello mind. I didn't touch that because I was afraid. But that's what I realized. We tune very often, we play a melodic melody. You do it in string quartet. And then the rest of the group tune justly. Now, how did that relate to what we're just doing? You have to save me. So you can, you have the melody, and then now don't start moving, don't only move the top note. If you decide you're tuning to the B, E, don't move the other note. People do that all the time. If you do that well and fast, the ear, it'll sound good, nobody knows. But when you're really practicing, you want to know who you're tuning to. So now play that E, and then play the high B, and now play the A major scale. Yeah. Now match that down low, like you can find it anywhere, that B is everywhere, but yeah, so now play your A major, going up, that was too high, then going on. So if we practice tuning melodically, you can only tune your fourths and your fifths and your octaves. Anything else will be out of tune according to the melodic tuning. But play now an E major scale. Just from the low. So when you play the low, you hear the high E. And if you do the low, the one you tune to the G is this. So it's different between this. I mean, for most people, it's like quantum mechanics a little bit, because if you play like a little bit out of tune but always consistent, then the listener's ear is very tolerant. There's a lot, but you're a little bit not always like right on. So you could spend time on that, 15 minutes every day on scales. So do E major again, but then listen. So you hear that E. I think people with great ears hear this instinctively and intuitively. No, don't do that. You can't do that. No, no. You have to do this one. The high E. And that E, if you tune perfect to the piano, when you get to the E, that tunes with the piano. Now go on with the scale.
Sorry.
going. A little flat. Not that, in between that and the other. Now do a B major scale. No, don't, you can't check with that. That's the one you don't want to check with. Yeah. The fifth partial, it's 14 cents flat relative to a piano. But the important is fifth partial is flat. And I remember when I started playing quartets, they always said, your thirds are too high. I didn't know, but I mean, you should have known with my ear. It's just when you play the string chord, that's why we have to play the low third. Mm-hmm. If you tune in C major chord, you have to. Yeah. We have to play the low third, otherwise it doesn't tune. So that's different. Now you're doing melodic, and you're playing with the piano, so you want to have the high E, and then the B major. So the high E there, now play B major. Keep going. Ah. The E you're playing, you just check it. It's just having parts that you can check. That you, if you do it 15 minutes every day, your ear will be much. You'll be different. Try to play now from the beginning of the with the Beethoven. I mean, you're so musical. You're so intuitive. It's beautiful. It's really, really good. But something. When you practice, watch when it's really good, and then try to watch what it is that you do, and then copy it in other places. But don't just play now the way you played before. Don't think anything. Just play without thinking. Sometimes the funny thing with the ear, we tune up, and then somebody else comes and plays it, then start playing more in tune because it opens the ears. And we shouldn't think. It's just instinctively. Don't think about it. Original manuscript, Beethoven had actually written the whole opening when the piano comes in unison with the cello. The cello played the whole unison part. Then he, as just to back it up, then he realized he doesn't like that. Because we have this wonderful book where they speak about the autograph. It's very interesting. But so when you come in there, if you play so loud, you should just, it's just to support. So you're just supporting the piano, so don't play so loud. You just, we have all these different roles. Also, I think it's good if you think hypermeter. So it goes on into the piano. We analyze the theme, of course, in three parts, and the second, but we don't need to do that. Just think like stronger beat. You sometimes play it on the G string. It's okay too. It's okay. I'm not, whatever, yeah. Yeah. It's all good. So yeah, it goes on. Make it go. Start here from the G sharp. That's your solo. Yeah. Really crescendo. Don't stop on the F sharp, because the fermata is on the E. I mean, with the B, can you play the high B that we spoke about? Play the B there. It's a little flat. That's a B. You play a B that tunes with the D. Don't do it.
Okay.
And if you did just tuning or piano tuning, even with the B, the high B fits with the piano, you know. Now go. Now go again back up to that. You're going up. Express it. Keep going. To the E. A little bit, maybe, do you want that? Is that on purpose? I mean, maybe it is, or maybe we go. I mean, if you do that, it's because you want to change the color. Don't do it just because you have a habit of going out. You always go up, but you're too far out, it's very good. You just be here. When you go here, and then, of course, it sounds good because you let it glide, but you don't need that for that. When you want to go here, you want to go soft and go up here, it's fine, but don't do it just to do it, because you have to do it for a reason. So, a little more color, more weight. Nothing. Long line. Three up at the top, but keep it going. Keep it going so it goes on, no stopping. So that's the spot where my ear is not happy, because it's too low, the B. I mean, the harmonic. See, it's not that high. And take the harmonic on the E, take harmonic. And when you're up higher, sometimes if you play a tiny bit higher, it's better than playing. If you play a little sharp up high, it sounds good, because the higher you go, the overtones for the ear cuts out, so we can't hear it. So I think sometimes, I've done a lot of tests with a lot of people with great ears, they like better when you go a little sharp. I mean, it's just a tiny bit, because then it sounds down low, you have all the overtones, but when you go up high, the ear can't hear that high. So to give it brilliance, a little bit higher.
Okay.
But for now, just play in tune, though. I mean, it's good. Then go and play up higher. Also, a little higher. I love her dearly. I love her dearly. It's very sweet. She's very sweet. Jingle pace. Then now, feel to the bottom. This is not nice. Play the E. So you're going a little higher there than you needed to. It's just being aware.
Okay.
And sometimes when you have a lot of emotion, musical and very musical, it's hard to stay objective about one's own. Because once you can't think that many things. So it's good when you practice sometimes, actually analyze your own emotion and your own when you play it, and then be able to play very musical, doing what you do when you don't be able to do that calculated. But then when you do that, maybe you listen to intonation or something. You can match up different things to think about. But not now. Then go for it. Yeah, go from there. Even there, the inner. That first finger is a little what?
The knife is a little low.
Yeah, a little tiny bit. Yeah. Just a comedy here. The dialogue duo. It's general, yeah, it's a thing with the bow since we brought it up. It's like when you go from the D string, then you go to the, you go there, so it doesn't speak. Just really, because you have to have long arm. So when you start the upper, it might be good to do the Piatigorsky exercise that you probably already, when you practice, just really out of the tip. You go like, so you get the same. So when you set the up bow, you know exactly where it goes. So you get the same for the up bow. Because you go up bow, you're a little bit off. So try to do that just to... And do it well. So you catch, and when you start the up, catch again. I'm sure he knows that one better than me. I've never seen it. Didn't you learn that from Piatigorsky? I'm sure you've seen that. I've never seen him teach that thing. You know it too, yeah, so I don't, maybe I'm not doing it the right way.
Leonard Rose also.
Oh, did the Rose? Oh, Rose did it. It's just...
You also do up bow with the frog.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, no, that's a great idea. So, ask about that.
Okay.
But I think it's just, so when you go up bow, that you really get it the right, because you're not placing in the right spot. And what's important is we initiate a lot of weight and then release the balloon. Release the bow. In the moment you release so much, the bow flies, then that's not good. It's too expensive. I used to say, no, you got to have more sounds. I go like that really hard. Then I broke two bows like that. It's really, and I had to pay for it. I don't do that anymore. See, you're good at the just come up a little higher and come in. Yeah. But so you have the... So you can really just grab it, grab the string. Let's finish with the middle part in F sharp minor, the most beautiful thing. Maybe go from... Can you play one from here? You know what I liked? You didn't play loud. It's very expressive. You can make it more beautiful. It's so expressive. Can you play one to G sharp? Play one to G sharp a little. Play it with the second finger. Play the second, vibrate. See if it's not vibrate more. Open the vibrato. So you can get in here. Because if you go. You get too much up, yeah. So try it on the A string, too. So do it again. Now, stay there. Very expressive. All the way. Really. Rip it. Yeah. So when it's soft and you slide, you navigate it very well. Try to do that forward now. I'm just about the posing. Try to do it forward. The first one. Play louder. Of course it shouldn't be loud, but that's very good. So you just observe when it sounds, if it doesn't sound good, watch what you're doing.
Yeah.
Very good.
Thank you.
Great job. Thank you so much. Very good. Yeah, very good.